Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome on behalf of the Law School and the Transnational Law Institute. It's our great pleasure today to continue the series of signature lectures in our context of offering post-Brexit reflections on where we might be headed and where, as you can see, where we are coming from. So just a little bit of context. So within this series, what we've been trying to do, also in part of the seminar that meets several times every month, we've been trying to take a few perspectives that might allow us to understand a little more the transformations that we are all currently trying to interpret. And particularly last week, we had a really fascinating discussion in the seminar over what might be some of the reliable reference points, what could be the foundations from which we should look at all of this. So rather than offering yet once again one very reliable foundation, we offer yet another perspective on one of the most vulnerable groups that we have identified in the program of the course as capitalism's outfalls. So we've looked at social rights, we've looked at labor rights, we've looked at democratic rights, and last week and today we look at people on the move, migrants, refugees, asylum seekers, displaced persons. So in that context, we've looked at a few writings that I brought here, last week, and now we turn more to the very concrete legal side, but you will see in our speaker today that you will get a perspective that places the legal analysis in a context. And Dr. Costello will also be so generous to contextualize a little bit her field itself and the types of questions she asks. So it's our great, great pleasure that you are here with us today. Dr. Costello comes to us from Oxford, and she is one, if you just look around a little, she's one of the most sought after experts right now on these matters. And rather than giving to you some of the scholarly writings, which you can easily find, we put into your program two blog posts. The reason for that is that you begin to appreciate that there are authors behind the texts that you're reading, right? So if you get a book, the next day you already forgot that somebody wrote the book and you won't remember the name even. And that's the same if you read articles. But if you read somebody's work and you see that it's intervening very concretely in a debate, that there are blog post comments to that, there are questions posed, there are hyperlinked references that lead you to other comments by other scholars and interventions, then you see that this scholarly work takes place in a very public realm. And there's hardly any reference that you can rely on. You have to create these references. And you have to say, my intervention is based on the following evaluation of the facts that I will lay out before you. And that's why we dared to send you two blog posts as academic writing. But of course, as you can easily see, there's a whole world of scholarship behind it. But you are supposed to appreciate and to see the public nature of these interventions. Okay, that was a very long introduction. Thank you so much for doing this. I will sit over there, and great. The floor is all yours.
Okay, thank you very much for the kind invitation. And I'm sort of envious of the richness that you've been exposed to in this course, because obviously it's very ambitious in its depth and breadth. And I hope I sort of meet the expectations, because what I'm going to do today is look at some very particular features of the 1951 Refugee Convention, but to look at them in order to problematize some contemporary practices, which I think are not only important, but I almost feel like they sort of define the contemporary predicament of the refugee, or at least certainly refugees who try to seek asylum in the global north, or in particular in Europe. I came to these issues partly as an EU lawyer. And obviously the EU commits itself to internal free movement, and that idea that mobility across borders could be normalized, it stops being a matter of sovereign discretion and it becomes an individual right to exercise various sorts of mobility, and the whole genesis of European citizenship was always very interesting to me. And in some ways I greeted the sort of creation of European citizenship with a bit of dismay, because I felt like, oh, that's to kind of renationalize the project of who has free movement within the EU even. Because obviously there were always outsiders to that project then, people who didn't hold the nationality of the EU member states. And in that context, refugees have been really left out of the European project even more, because there are some types of third country nationals who enjoy internal free movement within the EU, but they're sort of refugees are the category that are always apart. And in some ways this is quite unusual, because there is a general notion that the refugee is a privileged migrant, right? So that if you think about normal immigration control, you imagine that a state having the prerogative to admit or refuse somebody even at their borders, but the exception is for the refugee or somebody who claims to be fleeing and who claims to have either a well-founded fear of persecution or be at real risk of certain types of very serious human rights abuses. So refugees are often posited as the sort of exception that almost legitimates normal immigration controls. But I think what I'm going to be arguing today is that refugees are actually in a more complex and almost, I think, paradoxical position as regards their mobility. So the title refers to mobility and flight. So I guess flight is inherent in the definition of a refugee, which I'll speak to in a moment, but the definition has an exilic bias. You're not a refugee until you've crossed an international frontier. So you have to cross at least one, but the normality of refugees' flight is that they cross many. And often those onward border crossings are pathologized or legally framed in very different ways, which is part of what I want to speak to. And also their sort of onward migration is often treated very differently. So they're often, again, put apart from migratory regimes. So even in contexts where ease of movement is guaranteed, like within the EU for people who've been living in the EU for a long time, for example, refugees are kept apart for that. So the center that I work in is an interdisciplinary center in refugee studies, and there's a huge amount of scholarship within that interdisciplinary field about containment of refugees. So I suppose in some ways my talk is fitting in with that kind of genre of work, which says, yes, refugees are defined by mobility and flight, but actually they're also objects of containment policies, particularly policies of the global north that seek to prevent them reaching refuge and or formal asylum that would be available to them in the global north. And that's a story that scholars have told for quite a long time. I mean, in some ways it's hard to pinpoint when that era of containment began, but it's definitely something you could either trace it to the end of the Cold War, a lot of people do, or you could say actually it's just grown up with the growth of immigration controls. More generally, it's not quite a settled question. So in some ways, when I looked at the title of the lecture series, I was thinking, well, where do refugees fit in? I mean, in some ways, they're not a very contested category, in the sense that even, you know, you can look across a range of ideological and normative and ethical positions, say from people who believe in no borders to people who believe in a liberal nationalist polity with a fairly general control over its power to admit strangers into that polity. And yet there will be consensus on the exceptional category of the refugee. So in some ways the category isn't so contested, and as I said, for some it's a category that's necessary to legitimate the closure that states engage in, because if you were saying, as a polity, we have the right to reject all strangers, including people who would otherwise die because we don't want to admit them to allow them to live with us, then that might be a move that many people would think was deeply ethically problematic. So the figure of the refugee is the person in greatest need of refuge emerges from that. But nonetheless, I think in practice, obviously, refugees are a highly, extremely contested category, as I'm going to discuss. But I was also intrigued about this idea of transnationality, because obviously there's a lot of work on migrants being transnational, the reality of refugees or of migrants in particular coming and going, being equally at home in two places, transnational citizenship practices where people, you know, have circular migratory trajectories. They live for a while in one country and then go back home. They're still enfranchised in two places. And in some ways, refugees buck that trend because, you know, they get stuck Either they get contained in countries of first asylum. So you can see that with Syrians who fled to Turkey, Lebanon, and Jordan, and now the strong EU policy response is, that's it, we've had enough, no more. Lots of containment responses to the arrivals of 2015. But you also see it in the fact that, for example, refugees, when they've been granted asylum, aren't really allowed to go home, because if you go home, you risk losing your refugee status. Because if you re-avail of the protection of your home state, that's a legal demonstration that you're not really a refugee, because you're not in need, you don't live in exile anymore. So in some ways, I was interested in thinking about, well, to the extent to which refugees aren't really as transnational as one would expect, or at least aren't imagined to be as transnational as other migratory communities. So hopefully with some of the doctrinal stuff, I'll still get into these more sort of thematic questions that fit in with the sort of bigger questions that you've been asking. And on capitalism, I'm not sure where... I'm going to say something about smuggling and the role of third parties in facilitating movement. So that will be in a narrow sense about private actors and profit motives. I don't have a big theory of refugees and capitalism. I know you've read the Sasson book on expulsions, which is obviously about how certain forms of capitalism create displacement, but that isn't something I had planned to address, but maybe we can talk about it in the questions. So I'm going to start off, I'm not assuming that there are refugee lawyers in the room, but maybe there are, and it would be nice to know. Are there some, one or two, or anybody who's studied refugee law before or international? Oh, there's a couple, great, three, four. Okay, that's quite a lot. I'm going to assume not, so I'll maybe just set up some basic definitional questions and then talk a bit about the EU and where the EU fits into the world of refugees. And then I thought, given the series theme, I'll just have a bit of a Brexit parenthesis, because I think it's not an issue that I'm going to dwell on as such, but I wanted to put it in for context. And then the heart of what I'm going to talk about is the phenomenon of illegalized journeys for refugees. So why is it that a population that are acknowledged to be in need of a new home, at least temporarily, find it so difficult to move legally, and why it's almost the contemporary predicament of the refugee to be somebody who can't flee rather than somebody who's defined by fleeing and in search of protection. And then I was going to use the 51 Convention to talk about how the drafters actually envisaged flight and how flight would work for refugees. I'm doing some general work on the key provision which I'm going to speak to, which is Article 31 of the Refugee Convention, which talks about the duty of states not to penalize refugees for illegal entry. So it's a really interesting acknowledgement by the drafters that refugees would often, or maybe sometimes, or rarely, it's not quite clear, but that it wouldn't be a taboo for refugees to use illegal means to enter their countries of refuge. And that's also quite an interesting point to think about maybe the multi-level legal authority between international and domestic law, maybe even EU law in between, because it's an obligation on a state to not to apply its domestic law. They can still apply domestic law, but they can't penalize refugees for breaching domestic law. So it's kind of an interesting way of understanding how international and the domestic should work together. And my conclusion on Article 31 is that it provides a very limited set of protections. And we end up, I think, in a position which a lot of lawyers have tended to look to, which is, well, if we can't protect refugees from the adverse consequences of illegal entry anymore, if that provision doesn't kind of offer them the type of protection that the drafters of the convention envisage, then we have to think about legalizing refugees and using the law to actually create legal access to asylum. And that's, again, part of a wider narrative, but I want to talk about some very recent developments on that front. So some of it's going to be quite doctrinal, and I have a lot of slides, but partly the slides are just for information, so you have references to other material that you can look at if you're interested. So I'll go over them quite quickly. And by all means, ask questions at the end, and we can come back to matters of detail. So just on the definitional front, I guess there's often a tendency to condemn the 51 Convention definition as too narrow. So it talks about being persecuted or having a well-founded fear, rather, of being persecuted. So it's forward-looking on various reasons, which we could say are broadly political reasons. You have to be outside your country of nationality and be unable or owing to such fear, unwilling to avail of the protection of your country. So it has an exilic bias. It's a political definition. On the other hand, the definition gets, I think, critiqued wrongly for being, for example, too individual. Right? And sometimes it imagines that I guess you could read popular commentary or even well-informed commentary by non-lawyers, which assumes that persecution has to mean that you're singled out or individualized in some way by a bad government, and otherwise you're not going to meet the refugee definition. I think that isn't quite correct anymore. Just to illustrate, in practice, UNHCR these days tends to say most people fleeing Syria are convention refugees. So whereas you might read in the press, oh, if you're fleeing a general war, then that doesn't amount to the kind of individual threat that will make you a convention refugee, and that's just not accurate. You know, in most countries around Europe, people who fled the conflict in Syria are recognized as convention refugees because there is a link to their political status, their imputed political opinion, if they're living in a rebel-held area. Those are the factors that mean that their human right to life is at risk. So you're able to invoke and apply the convention definition in those sorts of contexts. And UNHCR issued new protection guidelines on people fleeing armed conflict. Now, that's not to say that isn't a really interesting development, because when people fled the Balkan Wars, there was a tendency to assume they're not convention refugees and that states should give them temporary protection because they fell. There was kind of an institutionalized assumption that they fell outside the convention definition. So there has been a major shift in the practice. The other thing to note is that the convention definition isn't the only one, and in all regions of the world you get additional refugee definitions, either explicitly, so in Africa and Latin America you have an expanded refugee definition that kind of basically says also known as refugees will be people fleeing additional types of generalized violence, for example. And in the European context we have another status for what are called subsidiary protection beneficiaries, which includes some conflict-related risks. And there's a view that under customary international law, there are additional norms of temporary protection. So the definition, I mean, again, it gets a bad rap for being too narrow or out of date or ill-fitting contemporary practices, and there's a huge critique there's no doubt a critique that it's too narrow that stands up. But some of the critique that it's too narrow is just legally ill-informed. So I think it's worth being aware of that. The point that I wanted to highlight, though, wasn't so much about the personal scope of the definition, but it's about the temporal one. So when do you think you become a refugee? So the definition talks about being outside your country of nationality, just, you know, is outside. The refugee is a person who is outside his country of nationality, and then has this particular fear, which means that they're unable or unwilling to return to seek to the sort of normal state of affairs, which would be to enjoy the protection of their country of nationality. So a question arises about when are you a refugee? So the alternatives might be when you flee, the moment you cross the border, or when the government that you turn to for asylum or you apply for recognition as a refugee grants you asylum. So which view do you think governments prefer? The flight moment or when they say yes? When they say yes. So the governments tend to think, okay, well, we make you a refugee, but the line in international law, and actually the only one that makes sense if you read the convention, is that you're a refugee simply by virtue of your predicament. And this is what's in the UNHCR handbook. Interestingly, it's exactly not the line that the BBC takes. There was a moment in 2015, 2016 where the BBC was getting thousands of letters about its framing of the refugee crisis, and this was its response to say, no, in our view, we use the word migrant until somebody is recognized by a state. And they, at least they say it clearly and explicitly now. And you can say, well, that's not legally right. You're creating your own universe as a broadcasting entity and your own discourse, but it's not grounded in any practice that's widely recognized. The other trope that came out a lot in the coverage was the idea that if refugees move on from their first country of asylum, that they stop being refugees. So Syrians who have a kind of protection status in Turkey, when they move, sometimes people will say, well, then they become migrants because they had protection and they lost it, and that's also really problematic. So that's in terms of terminology, the reason that that matters is that some of the protections that I'm going to talk about refugees. They say states shall not penalize refugees for their illegal entry. And of course, that protection would be almost meaningless if you said you only become a refugee when the government says you are a refugee after a process that could be protracted. So a lot of the protections in the 51 Convention presuppose this declaratory nature of refugee status. Okay, so the second is then just to talk a little bit about, well, where does the EU come into this and what has the EU got to do with refugees? And I suppose the point that we're at the moment is that the EU has claims to have a common European asylum system. So a lot of things to do with how asylum is regulated and granted are harmonized at the EU level at quite a high level of detail. So the procedures, the rights which asylum seekers have during the process, the status that they should enjoy afterwards, that status of subsidiary protection as well. But the genesis of the EU's involvement in asylum came in the 90s at a moment where there was a very strong sense, like the governmental discourse was that people who claim asylum are not really refugees, they're bogus, and that the process has to be made tougher, and the experience of claiming asylum has to be made unappealing, because otherwise it's too easy for people who just want to immigrate to use asylum as a sort of backdoor. And that's very different to other regional processes, like in Latin America or in Africa. In the African expanded definition is from 69, so you had wars of decolonization where states felt that African refugees were one another's collective concern. Whereas the European processes of harmonization, I think it's fair to say, have always been assuming that the refugee is the other. Whereas similarly too, you could say in Latin America there were moments where you had a genuine regional sense that people fleeing the Latin American dictatorships in the 70s and 80s were of regional concern, that somebody fleeing a neighboring dictatorship that there was a sense of regional solidarity. Whereas the European process has been kind of, the firmament of it has been in quite an exclusionary mode. But the interesting thing now for me to see is that nowadays, so there was in some ways some, let's say, official-looking truth to this, because most people who claimed asylum in the 90s didn't get it. So you would have recognition rates. For some nationalities, they would be quite high, but in general, you could generalize and say significantly less than half of people who claimed asylum were granted asylum in European countries. And that's no longer true. And for some nationalities, recognition rates are extremely high, like up in the 80, 90%. If you take refugee status and subsidiary protection together. And yet, we're in the middle of a whole new process of harmonization, which is also restrictive and also tightening up. So the fact that now we have real refugees, even by our own measure, hasn't created any sea change in how we understand the type of people that we're dealing with. So it's almost as if it doesn't matter anymore whether people are really refugees or not, whereas at least in the 90s, the official discourse to justify harshness was, well, look, we don't want to spend tons of money making decisions for people who aren't refugees. So there's a, I think there's a significant shift there. The other, I guess, kind of hallmark of what Europe did around asylum and refugees, as well as harmonizing and setting, quite elaborate standards, has been that those standards have never been accompanied by legal means to access asylum. So there's never been a general policy saying X number of refugees should be offered protection in the EU and we should give them a legal route to access that protection. It's almost built into the system tacitly that you have to make an illegal journey to claim asylum. that's not written down anywhere, but it's just a really strong institutional feature of the way that visa policies and other aspects of European migration policies are set up. And the reason I think that's important to bear in mind is, again, it's partly about framing what happened in 2015, 2016, when you did have almost a million people coming to claim asylum in Europe, so a very sudden kind of surge in the numbers of asylum applicants. Although, on the other hand, a normal year might still have been 300,000 or 400,000 people a year. Is that, I guess there's a well-informed view that I share, that what generated that was the backfiring of policies of prohibiting refugee movement, right? The reason that you got, I mean, we'll look at the numbers in a moment, but let's say 800,000 people going from Turkey to Greece in 1 year on rubber dinghies, because that's quite a short journey. You know, the reason for that, I guess, in refugee official parlance, you call it a mass influx, was that the demand for refuge had been building up, and safe and legal means of travel were unavailable to people, and this created a huge market for the services of smugglers, and briefly, a period of time where the cost of getting smuggled to Europe fell, and it became feasible, partly also because Syria was formerly a middle-income country, and you did have a middle-class population who were able to pay for that flight, and so there was an economic dynamic there too. Obviously, not everybody who came was Syrian. Lots of other nationalities joined, but it was predominantly catalyzed, I think, by the Syrian refugee crisis in the region. I think the reason this narrative is important, I think, is because, well, one, it's kind of legally well-informed, right? So the scholars I've cited here are three legal scholars based in Amsterdam. But the alternative narrative, which is, I haven't even attributed this to anywhere, but if you Google that, it'll come up like 100 newspaper headlines, is almost the one which is the official version, certainly in the Anglophone media and some of the German media, that something that Angela Merkel did brought a million refugees to Europe, and or that Germany had some kind of distinctive open-door policy. And none of that is really well established by the facts. We can talk about that maybe a little bit more. But I think the interesting thing about this framing is, of course, that it ignores the drivers of what people were fleeing from and the conditions in countries of first asylum, which were also such that, you know, refugees were keen to get out of a predicament where they lacked work rights, education prospects, really any prospects to reestablish a sort of normal life in the countries that they were in, and also that in particular, the conflict in Syria had worn on for so many years. At that stage, you were talking about 4 years, that people really didn't see the prospects of going home as viable. So all of the empirical and ethnographic work that was done actually asking people, why did you choose to leave at that moment, are a mixture of the opportunity presenting itself and the despair about returning home, and obviously the kind of smuggling dynamic, which was really about a Turkish-Greek dynamic and not so much about anything particularly being decided in Berlin that was going to influence everybody coming. And we could talk about that at some moments the German reaction obviously was to say we can manage this, but there's some analysis too by Thomas Beikebauer about the timing of Merkel's Wir schaffen das speech and whether it really made a difference. But as everything, because refugees don't travel legally, almost by definition, they don't arrive in airports or ferry ports, and they don't naturally disperse around Europe because, again, this is all, well, virtually all boat arrivals to Greece and some to Italy. It's a slightly different dynamic there. So this isn't very visible, but you can have a look. But the country on the left with the highest number of arrivals in 2015 was Germany. And then after that, Hungary, but people just move on from Hungary, so it's not that significant. And Sweden, which per capita has more asylum seekers than Germany. So people were just relocating themselves from Italy and Greece in particular, and making their way mainly, but not exclusively, to Germany. So you can see this is the 2015 sea arrivals. So you can, so you can sort of see it's the almost 800,000 people go from Turkey to Greece. That is the thing that was called the refugee crisis. people going from Libya to Italy is quite a different set of drivers and a smaller number of people, and it's much, much, much more dangerous. So the numbers of deaths at sea tend to be much, much higher on the Libya-Italy route. And of all of those people that went to Greece, nearly all of them made it to northern or western Europe. There are about 60,000 people still stranded in Greece now, unable to leave. There are tens of thousands of people just living in squalor across the Balkans, and then there's some really unfortunate thousands of people in prison in Hungary after Hungary decided that they should all be convicted of various border-related crimes that are actually denominated as terrorism under domestic law. So that was 2015 in a nutshell. And then 2016, I guess we could, is completely different. So the numbers arriving overall are much lower. So, you know, you've got only 170,000 people arriving to Greece, partly because of the EU-Turkey deal. From the point of view of my kind of hypothesis about the suppression of mobility, although the numbers arriving are much smaller, the numbers dying at sea are higher, right? So, which is partly because, again, the Libya-Italy route has become even more dangerous with the suppression of smuggling in that route. So I guess the theme that comes through here is just that there's something else going on, which is to do with the suppression of mobility, which leads to deaths at sea, which kind of means that the asylum system, although it has this great protective capacity if you get somewhere and claim asylum, and actually lots, large numbers of people are being recognized as refugees as a consequence of these arrivals. The suppression of mobility, which clearly doesn't work, evidently. I mean, 800,000 people, or almost 800,000 people, almost a million overall in 1 year, is an extraordinary number of people to arrive irregularly to any polity, if that's what the EU is. So I guess a lot of what I've written about this, and I'm happy to circulate these papers, is really looking at that dimension and trying to understand better how this suppression of mobility becomes the hallmark of the European refugee. So I don't think anything I've said in that is necessarily particularly controversial, but it is a very distinctive take, right, which highlights the impact of policies that suppress mobility. I think in some ways maybe it's, and I'd be interested in your views afterwards, is you know, how much does this differ from the kind of standard narrative, particularly the mediatized narrative about what's going on. I mean, I'm thinking about, in the Brexit context, the Farage pictures of refugees who were walking across the Balkans saying, enough is enough. So kind of attributing to the EU the, I guess, responsibility for arrivals of refugees. And I suppose in some ways you would say, well, okay, legally, what's supposed to happen if refugees arrive at your border is that you have to assess their protection needs. Right? So there's no legal way that Greece could have, when people were arriving en masse, just simply sent them away. So it's kind of interesting to think through, well, if this is being portrayed as a Greek or a European collective failure, it's a failure to do what exactly? And that's not always articulated, even in the EU discourse, where it does talk about, you know, failures of effective border controls. So politically, obviously, this played out in very particular ways in the context of the Brexit debate. But the Brexit debate is so divorced from reality in some ways on migration in general that it's all I wanted to do was inject a bit of legal accuracy to it. I suppose one of the things to think through in terms of the Brexit context is that the UK already is apart from all of the European asylum policies. So the UK has opt-outs. So the UK has been great as an EU member in making a case for its own exceptionality. So it's exceptional because it's not in the euro, it's exceptional because it's an island and it wants to maintain its own border controls. It's exceptional because it has a common travel area with Ireland. And this is one of those policy areas where, and I mean, this is just a primer that sets out the nuts and bolts of it, but it's really managed to, you know, pick and choose what it wants of asylum and immigration law and made an interesting shift from starting to be a participant in the asylum stuff and then deciding that it wouldn't when the second phase of that legislation was coming through, when the coalition government was in power. So in some ways, Brexit doesn't, if it changes the British position in these EU policies, it's that it'll be worse off from the point of view of control, because as a member, it had a complete choice about whether to participate or not. So if it perceived aspects of European policies to be nationally beneficial, it could participate from the very beginning and be at the table when they were being negotiated. And it would be giving up that right to become a non-EU member state, which might still want to associate with those policies, but would now have to, would have no right to do it anymore. So before the referendum, I'd written just one briefing note saying, really, asylum shouldn't be on anybody's mind in terms of an issue where the EU is requiring the UK to do anything that it doesn't want to do, or where the UK has commitments that it hasn't freely chosen on a case-by-case basis. But obviously the politics were very different. And I guess in the one of the interesting things about the work on public opinion and refugees in the UK, which is done by the Migration Observatory in Ireland, is that there tends to be a tenfold overestimation in British public opinion about how many refugees are in the UK. So if you go back to that table about where refugees are, the UK per capita has quite a low number of refugees and asylum seekers. And the public perception is always absolutely not. And British, when people are asked to estimate, they always estimate that there are more refugees and asylum seekers in the UK than in any other country in the world. So the political discussion and the reality are very different. So back to my sort of main narrative. I guess the main narrative is how, although the refugee is imagined as the exception to migration control, actually they've become the most controlled in terms of their migratory trajectories. And this isn't done through refugee policy. This is done through the fact that immigration policies and border control policies really bear down more heavily on refugees than on others. And the two policy instruments that bear down extremely heavily are visas and carrier sanctions, which actually you can't understand one without the other. And so visas, I mean, just to illustrate a complex point, whether you get a visa or not is often, visas are generally just for temporary admission or stay. So there are very few countries that run settlement immigration programs anymore where you would be saying, I'm going to apply for something like a US green card from the first day and make my new life there. I'm going to America and I'm going forever, right? So that normally immigration visas are either just for a tourist visit or a student visit or a short-term work permit, or and they're always designed on the premise that if you look like you might overstay, you can be rejected. This is kind of built into them. And so if you're coming from a war-torn country, or what we sometimes call a refugee-producing country, you will always be understood to be posing that risk. So if you're Syrian and you apply for a student visa, you may not get it just because that you are inherently posing a risk that you will claim asylum, and claiming asylum is the bad thing that you would do that will not get you your student visa. And so this is not kind of, this is by design, but it's not official, right? But it's nicely illustrated. This is from the EU's Fundamental Rights Agency. So it's Syrians applying for visas from 2010, and then as the war starts. These are applying for Schengen visas, which are short-term visas. And you can just see it just falls off a cliff. You more or less, without anybody making an official collective decision, you become ineligible for short-term visas. So that's it. Legal travel is gone if you're from a war-torn country. And then where carrier sanctions come in is that you can't get on a plane or a ferry without the visa then, right? So carrier sanctions are just a civil mechanism to regulate the transport industry, but carriers are risk averse, so they won't risk the fine. And so this becomes the reason people have to have recourse, not just to illegal journeys, which is something the drafters of the Refugee Convention envisaged, but rather that they have to do it completely illicitly through smugglers or self-smuggling or, you know, taking boats rather than planes and official ferries, and, you know, arriving on beaches rather than arriving at airports and ports. So what the drafters of the Refugee Convention did understand was that refugees would use illegal means to travel. And we see that very clearly in Article 31 of the Refugee Convention, which I always tell my students is my favorite article of the Refugee Convention, but I think that's just because then people think it's funny that you would have a favorite article. it's one of them. But it's an article I'm doing some work on. So I've been steeped in the sort of doctrinal questions, which I won't get into because of time, but I think what I want to do with it is just for us to think about the drafters in 1951 and why they included this. So what they included was a statement not saying a refugee has a right to asylum in a country of their choosing, or refugees may cross borders in search of protection. It was instead something much more limited, but in some ways something very practical then, which was to say the state's parties shall not impose penalties on refugees on account of their illegal entry or presence. And then there are provisos. And the provisos say, well, provided that you're coming directly from a place where your life or freedom has been threatened. So anybody notice what's the significance of saying coming directly from a territory where their life or freedom was threatened? So does that have to be your country of origin? Does it say your country of origin? No. So that was quite significant, because it doesn't mean, say, for a Syrian who's in Turkey, that moving on, if their life or freedom is threatened in Turkey, is illegitimate. It kind of acknowledges that refugees will have to make several moves, most commonly, in order to find asylum. And then there are other provisos about provided that you present yourself without delay to the authorities and show good cause for illegal entry or presence. So every single word of this has been analyzed exhaustively, partly because there's been, in the subsequent years, very restrictive practice with governments trying to really almost turn it on its head. But the interesting thing to do is to look at the drafting history. And so one of the fascinating things about the drafting history of the 51 Convention is that lots of people around the table were refugees or had refugee-like experiences during the war. And so the then UN High Commissioner for Refugees, Van Hoeven Goedhart, was quite concerned about this provision and said, well, look, when I fled the Netherlands, I had to, you know, use smugglers, and I did stop in Belgium for a while. And Belgium wasn't really going to be safe either, so then I needed to move to France and then Spain and then finally to a place of safety, a proper country of asylum, which was Gibraltar. And everybody in the room agreed, yes, that's okay. Like, fleeing is complicated, and that it's going to take quite a while to find a proper place of asylum. So there's quite an interesting, and in fact, what was on the minds of the drafters in terms of limiting the protection was really only the situation of where somebody had proper asylum in one country. Let's say, at the time, it was a French concern about, let's say, somebody who had asylum in Belgium. And if you really had the proper status of refugee in Belgium, then you don't get to move illegally to France and not be punished for that. So they weren't really imagining refugees as having any additional rights to mobility or free movement than anybody else. Like, there was that notion that part of the purpose of the instrument was to settle refugees in particular countries by having a status for them. But there was a really strong acknowledgement that mobility was the only way to find protection, that refugees would find their own places of refuge, that they would cross multiple borders to do that, that it might take them years to find places of refuge. And all of that came through very strongly in the acquis, or in the travaux. And it's also what has been reflected, at least to an extent, maybe not quite so fulsomely, in the case law and the provision. So there's some very interesting British cases where Lord Simon Brown, famously in a case in 1999, said that, well, nowadays this provision is needed even more, because when it was drafted in 51, there were legal ways for refugees to travel, and now there are virtually none. And so courts tend to acknowledge always and without much bother that the good cause requirement is met by refugees. So they don't even bother asking refugees, could you have gotten a visa to come here legally? It's accepted by the courts generally. That's a pointless inquiry because there is no visa for refugees. So some of the other provisions have been really much more controversial. But I think one of the other interesting things about the UK context, just to allude to very briefly, and I've put some references on the slides, is that the UK is praiseworthy in this because it's actually incorporated this provision into domestic law, but it's done it in such a narrow way that it has actually left refugees quite unprotected, because there's still zealous prosecution of refugees for border-related crimes and for crimes related to, in a broad sense, their irregular entry. So there are cases currently, a case currently awaiting decision in the Supreme Court, trying to really root out the prosecutorial practice, and the Criminal Cases Review Commission has been involved in reviewing miscarriages of justice involving the kind of overzealous prosecution of refugees, even though there's an Article 31 equivalent within British immigration law. So for this and other reasons, Article 31 ends up being, you know, hugely important, I think, to understand how refugee mobility and refugee agency, like the agency of refugees to seek protection, not anywhere of their choosing, but, you know, that they would have to flee and find protection was acknowledged. But as a practical protection, it hasn't really entirely met its objective. So the other way that legal scholars then try to look is, well, how do we break down all these access barriers that have been legally created? And in my simplified story, I've said the villains of the piece are visas plus carrier sanctions together. So what can, if that's really the thing that's putting refugee access to asylum at risk, are there legal ways to challenge those practices? And I guess there are other kinds of policies we could add into that equation. Some people call them non-entree policies, or just the policies that hinder the arrival of refugees to places of asylum. And I suppose just to reiterate a point that I made at the beginning, I think one of the features of those policies is that they clearly don't work, right? You know, a million refugees in 1 year or a million asylum seekers in 1 year later, they really don't work. So I suppose that was what I was saying at the beginning, that it's almost become the defining kind of hallmark of the refugee, that is, it is your desperation has to be manifested in your willingness to make life-threatening journeys. So there have been a range of different moves to try to create access routes through litigation and through advocacy. Some have been successful, like some of you might be familiar with a case called Hirsi that went to the Court of Human Rights that condemned the Italian practices at that time when the Italian Navy used to interdict people on the high seas and take them straight back to Libya. This was Berlusconi's Italy, and that's a policy which stopped for both political and legal reasons. But I just wanted to conclude with some thoughts about legal entry channels in terms of actually a duty to issue visas to people who want to claim asylum. We could also think about what are the obligations of private parties, of carriers? What about the airline that turns somebody away because they don't have their visa in order, because the airline risks a fine, and you think, well, the refugee risks their life. You know, is there no ethical or potentially legal obligation there to take the hit on the fine? And in fact, in some ways, those carrier sanctions have exceptions for refugees in them. It's just the risk aversity of the airline that means that they don't admit people if they're at risk of being fined. And the other part of the problem, I think, is the overbreadth of smuggling prohibitions, because it's not even the case, again, if you imagine a refugee fleeing, that let's say if a good Samaritan wanted to help you across the border, knowing that you're a refugee, there are also ways that their the actions of third parties in assisting refugees cross borders illegally have also been criminalized in many, many contexts. And interestingly, again, in the discussions in the 51 Convention, it was assumed that the law would be adapted to allow people to help refugees cross borders. So during all of these discussions about illegal entry, with the Dutch saying, my smuggler helped me get away from the Nazis, and everybody saying, yes, of course, we have to have a regime which allows private parties to help evacuate refugees, it was just assumed it would be dealt with somewhere else. And instead, what we've done is we've dealt with it using transnational criminal law and criminalized lots of assistance to people crossing borders illegally. So most of the policy prescriptions that are set up as alternatives to the world as we know it are discretionary. So we would say, wouldn't it be good if we resettled more refugees? Wouldn't it be good if we had humanitarian admission programs, if states just issued these humanitarian visas because they feel like it, if they were more generous in their use of family reunification rules? And I don't want to say that isn't the right move, that this should be left. And there are some interesting and I think important questions about whether creating spaces for governments to cooperatively agree solutions without legal obligations bearing down on them isn't a good way or even a better way to achieve cooperation than legal obligations, because legal obligations can often backfire. But I wanted to think a bit more about obligatory obligations across borders. So there's been a study looking in a lot of detail about the question whether, given the way European visa law is drafted, whether there isn't actually an existing obligation to grant visas to people who arrive at European embassies and say that their life or freedom is threatened, or in particular maybe that they're at an Article 3 ECHR risk of torture, inhuman or degrading treatment. And the report is quite persuasive. And there's some domestic cases that sort of picked up on this and started where you see judicial review becoming more demanding about visa refusals. So not quite saying the individual has a right to a visa, but really saying the visa refusal in these particular cases was unjustified. So not viewing visa policy as this kind of sovereign discretion where you didn't really have any due process entitlements. But most interestingly this week, in a case that's before the Court of Justice, Advocate General Mangazzi kind of, to simplify a little bit, endorse the view that there is a humanitarian visa obligation in situations where somebody presents themselves and applies for a visa. And the language, which it's only available in French at the moment, seems to suggest if that would be the only way to avoid the serious human rights violation that is threatened. So that's an interesting kind of concrete development. I think the second area where there have been some interesting developments is about challenging the overbreadth of smuggling prohibitions. So I'm going to conclude on this. One of my students wrote a great paper on this, which I'm plugging. But the way that smuggling offences are generally drafted is that any assistance to somebody crossing a border illegally can be criminalised as smuggling. The international legal definition says smuggling is only for material gain, and that produced some interesting case law about, well, if a taxi driver takes you across a border, is that for material gain? You would think, well, yes, you're paying the taxi driver. And some national courts actually said, no, material gain means excessive material gain. So we're going to let normal transport just take people across borders without asking about their legal status. But an interesting pushback came in the Canadian context when, and really out of a strong civil society campaign, of which this is the badge, the Proud to Aid and Abet Refugees badge of the Canadian Council of Refugees, the constitutionality under Canadian law of a very broad smuggling prohibition was challenged, successfully challenged in 2015. And I don't think they've yet amended the law, but the point of the case was to really just say, for family members at least, and for humanitarian organizations, the idea that assistance to people seeking to enter the country to claim asylum would be criminalized was just overbroad, but overbroad for particular Canadian constitutional reasons to do with how its domestic smuggling laws were framed. So that overbreadth doctrine was a Canadian domestic one. But nonetheless, an interesting pushback against the sort of overbreadth of smuggling prohibitions that we see at the moment. So to conclude, I guess the themes have been pretty, I think I've expressed them fairly strongly. If I haven't, then this does. If she drowns, she's a refugee. If she floats, she's an economic migrant. So somehow making refugees, in the European context particularly, defined by journeys. And again, that does permeate the public and the media narrative, saying, you know, well, you know, you have this discussion about, well, they're using illegal methods of entry, and people saying, yes, but that's a sign of desperation. That's somehow proving your refugeehood through the dangerous journeys. I think the discussion in the US and Canada is very different, where most refugees, or at least the most kind of public manifestation of refugeehood, is resettlement, which is an organized process of inviting refugees after a lot of security screening and interviewing. So it's sort of, I mean, the fact that resettlement has become one of Trump's many targets, when resettlement is actually the most organized and state-controlled element, a way of granting refugee protection, again, is just one of the many oddities of the various fairly benign things that are now targeted by the Trump administration. A completely alternative vision might be to start thinking about refugee status as a transnational status. But you can sort of read the Refugee Convention that way. But the Refugee Convention is actually quite statist, and there was an interesting discussion at the time it was drafted saying, well, a letter was written by Sartre and a number of other public intellectuals by the head of the predecessor of UN to the head of the predecessor of UNHCR, the International Refugee Organization, saying that refugees should be treated as global citizens. They said global rather than transnational, but that they were the harbingers of world citizenship, because having been, having had their link with a state ruptured fundamentally, the response shouldn't be reinsertion in a new state. It should be a status that would be transnational and allow kind of global mobility. I mean, they didn't emphasize the mobility side of it so much, but I think it was implicit in those ideas. Whereas really, I think the a strong part of the Refugee Convention is about reinserting a refugee in the national order of things, at least temporarily. So that alternative vision, again, I think you can work it through, and it might be an interesting leitmotif for some new thinking, but it's not fully certainly reflected in the Refugee Convention. Most of the practices that I've been talking about are, they're not exclusively European, but they're almost all of European origin. So the kinds of visa practices that I'm talking about, the sort of endemic nature of irregular journeys to claim asylum, the lack of other modes of access like resettlement. But of course, they have global impacts. So one of their most tangible impacts is that if countries down the line, which could provide asylum, start closing their borders, then at a certain point you get to the point that the border with the war-torn or despotic country is also closed. So for Syrians trying to flee to Turkey, Lebanon, or Jordan now, rather than, let's say, 4 years ago, it's virtually impossible. And the discussion starts to shift to discussion about safe zones within war-torn countries. And so there's a knock-on effect, which impedes the very basic notion of a right to flee. And the other aspect of the global impacts is kind of just through contagion, about what type of behavior and treatment do rich states in the global north make acceptable. And I'm certainly from policy circles and friends and colleagues who work in UNHCR, they say, look, this is the constant trope now, is why should we? 86% of the world's refugees are in the global south. And for countries in the global south who look at these practices, especially very harsh ones that are sort of very manifest, they invoke European practices when they say, well, why should we? And so Kenya was very vocal when it was threatening to close the very large refugee camps that it has for mainly Somali, not only Somali, but predominantly Somali refugees, and saying, well, look, you know, why should we when Europe doesn't? And again, that's partly to do with the fact of the perception, because of course Europe does host quite a lot of refugees, but if they come irregularly and induce a political crisis and then lead to some countries doing nothing and others doing very repressive things, as well as some fairly heroic ones, you know, offering a lot of refugee protection, then you don't really get the benefit of being seen to be refugee protective either. So I suppose those are some very personal takes on the kind of shape of, I guess, the role of Europe within the global refugee regime, and I suppose more generally about the law and politics of mobility, and how even that most mobile and deserving of figures, who is the refugee, has been sort of pathologized in this way, which means that the original premises behind refugee protection, if we think about the 51 Convention as embodying them, don't seem to be met. And obviously some refugees have put this more strongly, so we could ask whether there's bigger things at stake than just the global refugee regime. But I'm really interested in hearing your thoughts and comments and questions and having a bit of a discussion. So thank you.
So the floor is actually your, I guess you want to.
Maybe I'll take two, or will I take them one by one, or take a few and then get it? Yeah, maybe I'll take a few and I can see if there are themes. So yeah. Yeah, do you want to start up?
So I'd like to hear your view on the conclusions of the Code General that came out.
Mm.
Because I think they are conclusions that are quite legal in the sense that, whenever we are in the realm of European Union, the other charter applies and that kind of expands its applicability outside the territory of the EU. But on the other hand, they're quite political as well, in the sense that, like, the last paragraph is about the young boy called Alan, I think, who was part of the media, his dead body, who drowned on the Mediterranean Sea, I think, last summer. So I'm wondering what your stance is on the relationship between law and politics with specific regards to these conclusions.
Mm. Wow, well, you've read it. That's amazing. It only came out a couple of days ago, so that's good. Yeah. Anyone else? Yeah, go ahead.
I'm thinking about the UN, if we can call it lethargy or neutrality. What do we miss, really, to change or to adapt to the Refugee Convention to what we're facing now? Is it much more political than actually institutional? Because I see everyone criticizing the Refugee Convention. We need to adapt to the days that we are right now. But what do we need to do that? What's the missing part?
Good question. Yeah. Do you want to?
You said, according to your Article 31, but now the program it only provides limited set of protection. And so you said there's some prosecution cases to run by UK government, so I want to know the details why there's still adverse consequences despite the application of other programs.
Yeah. So maybe I'll start with that one because it's the most kind of specific one. So the British experience has been really, it's such an interesting case study. There's a great book by Anna Aliverti where she looks at the early stage of this, these prosecutions. Where, because there was an equivalent provision incorporated into British law, you would say, oh, well done, UK. Because normally, one of the problems with a provision like this in a dualist regime is that it wouldn't be incorporated into domestic law. And so it would be difficult for refugees to invoke that protection from penalization. But on the other hand, it was drafted in the UK context with only a very specific number of offences to which you could invoke this non-penalization clause. And then, for various reasons, the practice started, as I understand, of the Home Office sending all the refugee files to the prosecutorial authorities. And so asylum seekers and refugees were being routinely prosecuted. And these are, in the UK, it's a crime to enter the UK without a passport. So there's some nationalities where all of the asylum seekers of a particular nationality would probably be entering in an undocumented way. And then asylum seekers would end up in lower criminal courts with no representation, or with representation from criminal legal aid lawyers who didn't know any refugee law. And so it was, there were just hundreds of prosecutions where people pleaded guilty. And this was then sort of discovered, partly by accident, by, I don't want to make it sound like one lawyer's heroic story, but there was a barrister called Richard Thomas, who happens to know both criminal law and refugee law, who was very active in a lot of these cases. And then it was decided to involve the Criminal Cases Review Commission to say, look, these cases should never have been prosecuted. And so the bigger points that then started to get litigated was whether the prosecutorial authorities had a duty not to prosecute in cases like this. You know, is it enough? Because you could say, well, the provision only says don't penalize. Does that mean don't convict? So is bringing the prosecution itself a penalty? So you got into interesting interpretative questions there, but also interesting questions about what sort of obligations the treaty creates for the state. And basically, even though the higher courts in the UK have been pretty scathing about the prosecutorial practices, it hasn't stopped. So the current case that was argued before the Supreme Court last summer, but the judgment still hasn't been handed down. The intervention, the very interesting amicus brief was done by UNHCR, drafted by Raza Hussein, making the argument that even bringing the prosecution should be regarded as a violation. The problem with invoking it as a violation of the Refugee Convention is that, you know, you can't just invoke bits of international law that haven't been domesticated. So instead, he argued that that was a violation of Article 8 ECHR, like part of your general legal patrimony. So that's going to be interesting to see how the court deals with that argument. But it's a really interesting case study of different organs of the state seeming to have different priorities, and just somehow the overzealous prosecutions. And so, for example, there was a case of a refugee who walked through the Channel Tunnel and was prosecuted under the Railways Act, which isn't one of the listed offences. It obviously completely predates these immigration statutes. So there's just a prosecutorial vigour around irregular entry, and this provision has not been very effective in practice. The question about what's missing in the Refugee Convention, I think it's a really good one. There are two things that generally come up. One is the definition is too narrow, and two is there's no responsibility sharing prescribed in the Refugee Convention. So on the definition, I agree to an extent, but I think that case is sometimes overstated, which I tried to illustrate here with the protection considerations on Syria. It's definitely the case that institutionally, lots of people who claim asylum still don't get it, in cases where you might be quite surprised. You know, you might say, gosh, like a young boy from Afghanistan at risk of Taliban recruitment will typically be told there are other safe areas in Afghanistan if you relocate to Kabul, things aren't really that dangerous there. And so you can read those cases and really feel like, wow, that just seems like a tremendously narrow interpretation of state protection. But the definitional point is one. The questions about responsibility sharing, I think, are trickier because, and I was trying to allude to that in the end about, you know, there are times when maybe you don't want legal obligations and you want states to be able to negotiate differential responsibility for refugees. But that's a discussion, I think, where it's not entirely clear that ripping up the Refugee Convention would meet the aim, because this is a gap in the Refugee Convention that might be purposeful, and it's unlikely you would replace it with kind of an orderly system of allocated responsibility for the world's refugees per capita plus GDP or some other preordained formula. That seems very unlikely. So there are lots of things that could be done to improve the global refugee regime. I'm just not sure that they necessitate revisiting the Refugee Convention itself. The question that you posed about the opinion, and it's kind of, I guess there was a specific question about this opinion and then more generally about law and politics, but I suppose to me these are all cases that are at the constitutional level, right? So they're where it's hard to see where does doctrinal law end and where do questions of constitutional values begin. So a question like, you know, at what point do, so does the charter apply extraterritorially, for example? I mean, I think that's a constitutional question. I've written a book chapter with Violeta Moreno-Lax where we couldn't find any reasons why it wouldn't, right? I mean, there are reasons why some human rights treaties have jurisdiction clauses where they talk about territory or they talk about territory or jurisdiction, or there's a PIL notion of jurisdiction that informs the scope of a human rights treaty. There's no particular reason why the Bill of Rights of a polity like the EU should be territorially grounded, especially when the EU just doesn't itself have a territory. So I guess in my eyes, that was a question that needed an answer constitutionally, where you would look at the spirit, the scheme, the wording, the kind of constitutional nature of the EU to answer the question. So I don't really see the law and politics as separate there. Obviously, there's rhetoric in the opinion, which kind of locates it very much within a particular political context. And I guess that's really a matter of judicial style. I mean, the Court of Justice speaks in this anonymized collective voice, but so there's a bit more personality in the opinions. Obviously, in the Strasbourg court, it's different because the judges can do separate opinions. So if you read, I don't know how to, the Portuguese judges' opinions in cases like Hirsi, you know, they're also a big excursus into values and, you know, the universal promise of human rights. And I think that's just really a matter of what's an appropriate judicial tone and rhetoric. I'm not sure I have any other view about it than that. But I do think these are constitutional kind of questions. So you wouldn't really expect doctrine to give you the answer. Like, they're generally at the point where the rules are unsettled or highly contested, so it's going to be an interesting. So they'll have to be argued at a kind of higher, at a higher level. Okay, yeah, sure.
The very down-to-earth one, I guess. How do you bridge the gaps between those wonderful doctrinal findings, and the narratives, the public opinion narratives that see, that put all in one cauldron, migrants, refugees, asylum seekers, all that, and you were mentioning the example of the UK population looking and feeling that there are much more refugees than there actually are here. And I could, as an Italian, I could mention the example of people arguing that migrants are taking money from public finances because they are being paid 35 euros per day to stay in Italy where they await their refugee status to be clarified or whatever. How do you put into simple words all these legal, these political also findings?
Sure. One over there. Yeah.
My question is back to the notion of the migrant more general, and to me it seems to be standing a dichotomy between the notion of the citizen. The more I'm a citizen, the less I'm a migrant. And you've criticized the EU citizenship for its othering effect. So my question would be, what do you see the future of citizenship as a concept? Which function should it play or have in a polity?
Big questions. Yeah, maybe one more and that might be enough. Yeah, sure.
I'm sorry I came in late, so because I was in another class, it might be something you've already covered in the first half hour, but I was wondering what you see the role of race and racism in this whole shift that you described in the way that the Refugee Convention is applied, because I guess sociologists or political scientist Aaron Kandani kind of makes the point that when we first had the concept of refugees, it was sort of white people from Eastern Europe first and foremost, and it was relatively small numbers, and people could kind of cope with that. But it was when it became large numbers coming from the Middle East, Asia, Africa, that it really started to become a problem. And I mean, one thing that really struck me, my father was a refugee from Egypt in 1956, and I asked him recently, just suddenly occurred to me to say, how did you actually leave? And he was like, oh, we just left on a refugee passport, we just got a plane. And you think that's, as you were saying, a completely impossible thing to do now in the way that visas are denied. So what is there a sort of role of race in that kind of pulling back of those meeting those obligations?
Yeah. Gosh, so these are really sort of bigger questions. And in some ways, maybe I'd like to hear what people think. I mean, I think the gulf between, like, the first question about public opinion, I mean, I think you could say that about so many areas of life, right? So, and in some ways, it's not always a bad thing. I mean, we all operate, you know, in some areas with a degree of knowledge and expertise, and on other areas just on trust and on our understanding of how things work from popular culture and media and conversations. And, you know, we can't ask that everybody's an expert on everything. I suppose there's just a difference when some things are kind of dangerous levels of misinformation, civically dangerous levels of misinformation, and how can you counter them? And those are usually being generated from somewhere else, right? So you have, you know, political forces that exploit and lie about marginalized and minority groups for political gain. And that's been definitely a feature of the refugee crisis, and not only in countries like Hungary and Poland, but, you know, these are politicized, completely taken advantage of by far-right groups. We know that those far-right groups are often funded by Russia. I mean, there are political currents that are really dangerous that need to be understood on their own terms. It doesn't worry me a whole lot that people have misperceptions about foreigners and strangers, because that's, I mean, in some ways, some of that is just going to always happen with the unfamiliar, right? So this is like just part of the human condition. If you don't know people from a particular part of the world, or you're just lacking that, there'll always be a gulf of understanding. So the question then becomes more interestingly about how do you create opportunities for people to get to know one another? How do you make sure that asylum seekers and refugees aren't socially isolated? And after that, you can just sort of hope that, you know, just getting to know people gets over a lot of the fear of the other, and the misinformation doesn't become toxic. So I suppose there are just questions there about institutions and what kind of practices and institutions you'd want to build from the bottom up to foster kind of inclusiveness. On the citizen thing, I guess, I suppose, I don't have a short answer, but one thing that I would say is that, you know, the sharp edges of nationality and citizenship in Europe haven't been softened by European citizenship. You know, there was a moment where we thought, well, if you create this transnational EU citizenship, that it will kind of have an inclusive dynamic, but it hasn't worked like that. You know, it's meant that states have gotten sort of tighter and more selective about how they grant nationality in some instances. I guess the pattern is kind of mixed, and some of the best work on that, on let's say how European citizenship has changed naturalization practices around Europe, kind of tends to trace both an inclusive and an exclusive dynamic. But I still really feel like formal nationality really matters. I mean, Brexit makes that really palpable. It really matters what your passport is. It's not a matter of saying, you know, we're past all of that. I mean, I think nationality is resurgent. And so I don't think, there was a time when people used to say, well, citizenship was being devalued because it didn't really matter what nationality you had. And I just think that's nonsense. Like, there's such stratified value to citizenship. And obviously British nationality is going to diminish in value with Brexit. So I think those relationships are complex, but I'm definitely not somebody who's of the citizenship is an kind of passé concept. I mean, on the race, racism, I guess there's a question about, like, that narrative which says Europeans were happy with European refugees and sort of then tends to focus very much on the Cold War experience, where you did have this kind of huge, obviously, Iron Curtain and politics of immobility from Eastern Europe. And so it is true then that, you know, if people turned up on a boat from Poland to London, they would just be offered refugee status, just like that. You know, there was no question of sending people back for ideological reasons. But the 51 Convention predates that. You know, the refugees that people had in mind were millions of displaced people in Europe. So it was people who were displaced by events predating 1951. And then I think it is worth remembering how deep the enmity was across European countries and how deep the sense of foreignness was. You know, so I think it's kind of too complacent to say, oh, well, it was Europeans altogether. I don't think in 1951 people felt like we Europeans are here all together just 5 years after the end of the war. You know, I think, you know, there was no question but that Europeans were complete foreigners to each other. So I suppose the them and us narrative about Europe and others is powerful, and it is racialized and it has a colonial dimension, but I just wouldn't want to forget the fact that, you know, Europeans were also really foreigners to each other. And in that context, then, some of the moves around Eastern European refugees were really interesting. Like, if you read the testimonies around Hungarians, 1956, I know you mentioned your dad was 1956 as well, but, you know, a couple of hundred, well, what was it, about 120,000 Hungarians flee really quickly to Austria, which still has lots of displaced people from the war, and those 200,000 are immediately resettled and relocated all around the world. Within a few weeks, UNHCR has pledges. And the Hungarian refugees who came to Britain have testimonies saying, oh, it was great because everybody assumed that we were intellectual types because Lord Calder was in the cabinet. So people benefited from these huge positive stereotypes about the kind of people who were fleeing communist countries, which weren't accurate, but they were positive stereotypes. So again, maybe about misinformation can be helpful. And so you did have this, just a different sort of more welcoming dynamic. Definitely things shifted at the end of the Cold War, and I think it was partly to do with the types of refugees, partly this perception about bogus, but also about poverty. Right? So, you know, when we think about, is this always about racial exclusion? I think, you know, the mass movement of poor people is something that there's always been massive unease about, even domestically, if you're talking about kind of the mobile poor historically. So I don't want to say no to a racial narrative. I just think, it's interesting to think about in what contexts exclusionary xenophobia takes hold and in what context it doesn't. Because who you perceive as the dangerous other, as opposed to the welcome other, is really interesting. And obviously the huge contemporary phenomenon is the acceptability of Islamophobia. Right, you know, it's just astonishing that even, and I can just even palpably see how this much has, how it has changed in the last 5 years, you know, just how acceptable it is to make generalizations about Muslims and security threats and all of that. And again, obviously, Trump makes this all seem, you know, so much more vivid and exaggerated and appalling. But So I guess, yeah, it's interesting to think about when does that narrative become acceptable and take hold, and when does some more exoticized and interesting narrative about refugees and how great they are and how, what sort of skills they bring, which maybe equally are, they're just more positive stereotypes. But I think trying to understand those dynamics better would be really interesting. Yeah, good. I think that's probably, you have to give up the room. Yes.
Let me just say, so each week we reach this moment somehow that it's 8 p.m. or 6 p.m. or session ends, and we find that, you know, that I have much more time. But maybe one way to continue this is that we exchange a little correspondence and see what you think we should be looking at in terms of history.
right.
Thank you so much for coming today.